Lalit, I hand it over to you and you can take the session forward.
Thank you, Lanka. Good afternoon, sir.
Hi, Lalit. How are you?
I'm good, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for taking time and coming for this Zoom conversation. We will start with the question. All the youngsters who want to ask some questions from you, I'll ask first of all to Sakshi Jha, who is asking you the first question.
Hello, sir. Good evening.
Sakshi, can you please ask?
Hi,
sir. I'm from Chennai. I'm 19. And my question to you is, what inspired you to join the army and what was your biggest lesson that the uniform taught you?
Okay. You know, when I was small, World War II started. I was born in 1937. World War II started in 1939 and finished in 1945. My early years were spent listening all about war. And I used to read comics and books about the war. And my dad used to keep telling me what was happening on the Western Front and the Eastern Front. So I was interested in the army. And I had five relations who were in the Army, Navy, and the Air Force. I was very impressed with their uniforms. And outside my house, near the dining room, there was a big camping ground where soldiers used to camp and go off to the Western Front and to Burma. And I used to watch them getting up in the morning, doing PT, to bugle, et cetera, et cetera. So I said, wow, I'll have a tent of my own and a gun of my own one day. And so this is what initially sort of made me join the army. And then later on, I realized I just want to live a life where I went to the same office every day, see the same faces. And I got to know that the army was a life of adventure. You know, places, you climb mountains, you drop from aircraft, and you fought with the enemy. And I said, well, that's the type of life for me. And then I also used to read a lot. Even when I was very small, I used to read a lot. And I was convinced that I had only one life to live, and that I should live a life which is exciting. And not a boring life and not be happy with whatever I had. And so that was why I decided that the army was the place for me. And that's why I joined the army. And then what else did you want to know?
What is the lesson that the uniform taught you?
Oh, you said what is the lesson actually? It's not one lesson. The army taught me many lessons. I'll just tell you three of them, all beginning with the word see. And the first one I learned is cooperation. Now, you'll say how. When I was in the NDA, I wasn't good in maths. I wasn't good in Hindi. But I was topping all the other subjects. So my divisional officer said, son, you need to do well in Hindi and maths. So I said, sir, but I don't have time because I'm boxing, I'm swimming, I'm playing hockey, I'm doing this and that. And I got no time. So he said, well, the nights are yours. I said, sir, we have to sleep at 10 o'clock and lights out at 10 o'clock. I can't study after that. So I don't have to tell you what to do. So I used to study with a blanket over my head and a torch and studied, and still I wasn't making headway. And then he said, son, there's something known as the principle of war, and it's called cooperation. You cooperate with others, you help them out, and they will help you. So I helped all my course mates in English and literature and grammar and composition, etc. And they helped me out in maths and Hindi. And in my last but one term, I was second in the order of merit. In the final term, I was first in order of merit. So cooperation is very important. What you can do by yourself is good, but what you can do with others is fantastic. So the first thing was cooperation. Something I learned, again, it begins with C, and that is confidence. That confidence only comes after you keep on trying. If you don't try, you won't win your little battles. But with each little battle that you win, you get more confidence to do bigger things. So cooperation, confidence, and character. I also learned that if you are a good human being, people will respect you, people will help you, people will recognize you, appreciate you, and you will be happy with yourself. So character is very important. So I learned these three things in uniform, which helped me in my career and after I left the army also. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
For the next question, I would like to call Savni. Savni, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Yes, sir. Jain, sir. Good evening.
Jain.
Sir, my name is Savni and I'm from Nashik and I'm 16 years old. And I would want to ask you that we all have heard and read about this incident from various sources, but we want to know from you that how did you decide to cut your own leg and where did that strength come into you from?
Samnik, I have fought three wars. And the war in which I saw maximum action was the 1965 war. I was a company commander then, and I was involved in attacks, in raids, in ambushes, and I was caught in a very big ambush. I was just with a strength of about 40 people, and I was caught in an ambush which involved 300 of the Pakistanis. And we suffered very heavy casualties. And many of my very good friends, people who I had grown up with, whom I trained, whom I loved, were killed in front of my eyes. And they were in a very bad state, heads knocked off by rocket launcher blasts and guts splitting out, and limbs torn away. So I saw a lot. And when I got wounded in 71, I realized that I wasn't as badly off as my friends. I felt that losing a leg is not such a great big deal. And the leg was very badly injured. And I realized it couldn't be saved. And it was looking very offensive. And I decided, let's get rid of it. So I told the doctor to cut it off. But we were in that battle of a place called Sylhet. And the enemy artillery had destroyed our MI room. So there was no medicine. There was no instruments to cut off my leg. So I asked my Gurkha soldier to give me my copy. And I said, this off. So he said, Ali, I said, we waited for the doctor long enough. He hasn't come. It's 45 minutes now. Give it to me. And I cut off my leg. And as I tell everybody, I now own land in Bangladesh. One foot by one foot. So that's how I cut off my leg. And I people give me a lot more credit than I deserve, I think. Anybody in my situation would have done the same thing.
I have my doubts on that, sir, but we'll take your word for it.
Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you, Savni. For the next question, I would like to call Shriyanka.
Good evening, sir. Aman, have you joined? Because sir, Aman wanted to ask you this question and he had said he would be joining late. If he's there, he'll ask you.
Okay.
I don't think Aman is here. So, sir, I'll ask the question on Aman's behalf. He has said that he wanted to know any very funny incident with any of your Gorkha troops that you would like to share with us.
I don't know whether it is funny. I found it funny. I was telling you that I fought the 1965 war. And I had trained my company. We had lots of casualties. I had to rebuild the company. And I was strongly involved with them personally, physically. I mean, we were bonded together and we were very close. But then I had to leave. I went to go on a staff posting. And then I'd gone to staff college when the war broke out. So when I joined them, the battalion had already fought two very ferocious battles. And now they were being inducted into Sylhet by helicopters in India's first heliborne operation. And I managed to catch the last flight at 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. And when I landed in Sylhet, my bigger Johnnies of my company who were with me in 65 were running from three or four of them from one helicopter to the other looking for the Kartusab. They called me Kartusab because they couldn't pronounce Kartusab. So they were looking for Kartusab. And when they found me, in the middle of that battle, there was artillery shelling, there was machine gun fire, there was mortar shelling, and a lot of gadavat going on. But in the middle of that battle, they put me on their shoulders and started dancing and saying, Kartusab, hoi ki hoina, Kartusab. So they were very glad that I had come. And I was very glad to be there with them. Wow. So I don't know whether you find it funny.
No, but sir, I think
that was one incident.
It's a wonderful story. And that also answers one question which we had planned to ask you later, was how did, why were you called Kartusab by the troops?
I was called Kartusab because they found it difficult to pronounce Cardozo. They used to say all sorts of funny things. And when Kartusab, you know what Kartus means? It means cartridge.
Yes.
So they found it nice, and I also said it's okay, fine. So that name stuck. Another incident I'd like to tell you about, which happened before my time in World War II, is my battalion was fighting in Germany, and we had captured a village, and there were many German bodies lying around. There were 9 of them. And there was no time to bury them individually. There was a big bomb crater. So the British officer said, throw them in the crater and then bury them. So the Johnnies were throwing one after the other. When they came to the last one, he had not died. He was alive. So he screamed in terror. So the Gurkha Johnny took out his kukri and was about to decapitate him. And the officer said, what are you doing? So he said, Saab, I was told to bury 9 German. This one is alive. So how can I bury him alive? I have to kill him first. So I found that rather funny.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing these with us. I think everyone really enjoyed these stories.
Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. For the next question, I would like to call Sudarshan Muralidharan.
Jain, sir. I'm Sudarshan from Chennai. I'm 19 and I'm an army aspirant. My question to you is, sir, how did you keep yourself positive and motivated, especially after that incident? And what pushed you to overcome it? Thank you, sir.
When I was in hospital, we were told that you guys who lost your legs or hands or whatever, you can't command troops, so it's better that you leave the army. The government is offering you a lot of concessions, land and school facilities and this and that and the other. But I felt that this is the only life I knew. I loved that life. And I was not prepared to live any other life. And we used to have a sister who used to come once a week and give us books to read. And she gave me a book called Reach for the Sky. It was a story of a Royal Air who lost both of his legs. And then, despite that, they allowed him to fly. He fought in World War II, flying a Spitfire. He shot down 21 German fighter planes, became an air ace, and he had lost both his legs. So I said, if he can do that, why can't I serve as an infantry officer? So I said, I have to find a way out. At that time, I had no idea what I would do because I did not know what the answer would be. But I knew one thing, that I did not want to serve the rest of my life as a Babu in uniform. And so I decided to do my best. I did the BPET test, and I did many things, climbed mountains, swam, took part in events, races. And finally, I climbed a mountain, and the vice chief and the chief decided to give me a chance to command a battalion, because I had done many things which any other person could do. So when I climbed that mountain and he came down in a chopper and he said, how have you come here? So I was a little surprised. I said, what do you mean, sir? He said, did you come here in a chopper? I said, no, sir, I climbed. So he said, you can climb. I said, sir, what I cannot do lies in the minds of my senior officers. So he went back to the chief and said, sir, this boy can run. He's taken part in the BPT tests. He's passed all the tests. He's done better than 7 other officers in the 2-mile run. He can climb mountains. So why don't we give him a chance? So then I was given a chance to command a battalion. And when I joined the battalion, that's another story altogether. It was a different number of different tests which came before me, but which I managed to solve.
So you must tell him that story. The walk,
okay,
in the desert, that story has to be told.
Okay, so you know, when I joined my battalion, they were already in the desert in Rajasthan. And I had been training in Delhi, doing 6 to 7 kilometers every day, running, walking, etc. I ran so much that the metal bolt which secures the rubber foot to the wooden leg, through basic metal fatigue, sheared off and I fell. Just to tell you that I was training hard. But when I went to the unit, and they thought, this guy has, one-legged fellow has come to the battalion. I'd gone to my battalion after 17 years, because in between I had fought both the wars with another battalion. Now I was going to the battalion to which I was commissioned. And they felt that this CO Saab is without one leg. How can he do anything? Battalion was a very great battalion. It had 4 Victoria Crosses, any amount of decorations, always done well in war and in peace. And they probably thought that I'd be a passenger. So I took 2 bottles of Scotch whiskey with me to say, I'll come back. But there wasn't very much of a warm welcome. So after dinner, I said, what is the program for tomorrow? So they said, we are going on a 40-kilometer route march. There'll be a jeep for you. So I was taken aback because I'd done 6 to 7 kilometers. And now on my first day in the unit, I was told that they're going to go on a 40-kilometer route march. And by that time, I had got a lot of confidence and I was telling everyone that there's nothing I can't do. So I was boasting. And now I was faced with my first day in the unit to march 40 kilometers in sand with a leg that had no ankle. But I thought to myself, you've been talking so much. Now is your test. If you can't do 40 kilometers, you don't deserve to be CO of this battalion. So I told myself, whatever happens, I will do this march. And I started marching at 5 in the morning. And it took me nearly 10 hours of non-stop marching. I knew that if I stopped, I would get blisters and I would not be able to complete the march. So from 5 in the morning till 4 in the afternoon, I marched non-stop. But this is a message that I'd like to give to everyone. When I finished that march, I got a surge of confidence. And I realized the meaning of empowerment. That I said, henceforth, nothing can stop me. And I called all the officers. I got a lot of confidence. And I said, listen, you guys, if you think you've tested me, forget it. I've tested myself. from now onwards, you will come to up to my standards of physical fitness, or I'll not spare you. So that was the start of my life in my battalion, which is not a good start, but that is how it was.
What an inspiring story. I'm sure it's very inspiring for everybody to hear.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you so much.
But you know, after that, there were some more tests. After that, I went to a peace station called Trivandrum, and we had to do a 150-kilometer march from Kanyakumari to Trivandrum. 150 kilometers, 50 kilometers every night. Mm-hmm. So again, I have to tell myself, if you are commanding this unit and you're trying to prove that battle casualties are as bad as anybody else, you've got to do this 150. So I did it. But in the process, my leg was a mess. It was bleeding. I should just put plasters and just carry on. But it happened. So now the officers, of course, the men were quite happy. The officers realized that, well, this guy is not taking things lying down. He's trying. But what finally proved the case was, I mean, proved that I was, you know, we people who are disabled, we sometimes talk a little too much. But what I'd like to say is that we try to prove, not that we are as good as others, we try to prove that we are better than others. And the test came and we had gone for a picnic to Kovalam. Kovalam is on the seashore, and it is the month of June. Monsoons were about to start and the waves are very high. I'm very good at swimming. I have taught about 300 to 400 children how to swim. And one of the boys who I taught to swim was caught by a big wave and carried out to sea. Started shouting for help. And nobody had the guts to jump in and save him. So I had to take off my leg. I had to be helped by two other officers to get into the sea. By this time, we had gone about half a kilometer. And I swam up to him. And I realized that if he puts his arms around me, then both of us will go. So I said, son, don't touch me. I will support you. I'll keep your face above the waves. And there were a long line of rocks. I said, we'll head for those rocks. And if we can't reach those rocks and we go out into the open sea, don't worry, a boat will come. But don't put your arms around my neck. Mm-hmm. And I now had my two arms supporting him and kicking with only one leg. I was very much doubtful that whether we could reach those rocks. But luckily, God was with us. Reached those rocks, and I put him on top, and all those, his mother and everybody was watching from the seashore, wondering what would happen, and they were very, very happy that he could be saved. And then I had to swim back to the shore. It took me 45 minutes because the tide was going out, and there was a huge crowd, and when they saw that I was only with one leg, they were very surprised. And they wanted to, there were some journalists who wanted a story, so I said there's no story. But this incident proved that I was not as good as others, but in some ways I was better.
Absolutely.
So each of us, in whatever occupation or career we follow, we will all have our challenges. And we have to prove not only that we are as good as others, but that we are better. And that can only happen if you have confidence in yourself, faith in God, and do your best.
Thank you, sir. It's fascinating.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir. For the next question.
That rifleman here, no, who wanted to get introduced. Sir, we have...
yes, Ranjit Singh. Mr. Ranjit Singh.
He heard that we were doing this talk with you and he wrote to me on Insta saying he's taken an hour off from his sergeant and he's here with us. He wanted to get introduced to you.
Okay.
Where are you, rifleman Ranjit? Aap zara... dikhaiye kahan hai aap, Shriyanka, can you highlight him? Madhuri, can you please highlight him? There he is.
Jai Hind. Ranjit, Jai Hind. Aap kaun si pattern mein hai?
Main Tanjore mein hai sab.
I couldn't understand.
He's saying Jacklai.
Jacklai, okay.
Now I'm posting Fine, sir. I'm fine, sir.
You're fine. Where are you? Where is your unit? In P station?
Yes, sir. Sir, currently my unit is in New Delhi, sir.
New Delhi? Okay. We can meet one day.
Yes, sir. But I'm posted in Srinagar, sir.
Oh, you're posted in Srinagar. Okay. All right. Yes. Good.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank Ranjit. You, sir.
Do well. Do your best.
Yes, thank you, Ranjit. Thank you so much. Thank
you. Yes, ma'am. For the next question, I would like to call Sri Krishna.
Good evening, sir. This is Sri Krishna. I'm 20 years old. I'm from Chennai, and I'm an army aspirant. First of all, I'd like to state on behalf of everyone that it is a great honor being here talking to you in this video call. And my question is, was there anyone in your life who was by whom you were very inspired? It could be someone from the army or someone from your personal life. Was there anyone like that? Thank you, sir.
So you asked me who is the person now? Yeah, and I'm glad you asked a very good question. And a personal, my professional life, and a personal, my personal life. Okay. In my professional life, the person who motivated me was an officer from my regiment. He's a very famous person, and his name is Sam Manekshaw. You heard of him?
Yes, sir. He's my personal favorite, actually.
Okay, so he's my favorite also. He was from my regiment, the 5th Gurkha Rifles. And when I came to Delhi to get my gallantry out of a Sena medal, he was the Western Army commander. And we both wore the same lanyard. You know what a lanyard is? On the right-hand side is a cord. It's red in color. So he saw that and he came up to me and he said, "You're 5th Gurkhas?" I said, "Yes, sir." So he said, "You started life well." I said, "Thank you, sir." Of course, since you know he's your favorite, so you know all the stories about him. But yes, but I asked him, I said, "Sir, can you give me some advice?" So he said, "Son, you started well. I'll give you 4 bits of advice. Number one, love what you do. Now, you are an army aspirant. So if you want to join the army, obviously, you must do what you love. So the very fact that you're going into the army, and when you get into the army, be very happy that you have got what you wanted. But that is not enough. After doing what you love, then he next said, you must love what you do. And that meant that you have to be the best. You have to work hard. You have to do everything possible to be the best soldier, to be the best officer, or whatever calling you are in, whether you are an actor or whether you are an engineer, a doctor, or a lawyer. You have to love what you do, and therefore you have to work very hard to make sure that you are the best. And then he said that there will be lots of challenges that will come your way. Life won't be easy. So never be afraid. And you must have heard that story about him. He said that when somebody asked him, are you afraid of anything? So he said, yes, every man is afraid of something. Some men are afraid of many things. If anyone says he does not know fear, he is telling a lie or he must be a Gurkha. So he said, never be afraid. So first, number one is do what you love. Number two is love what you do. Number three is do not be afraid. And lastly, he said, never give up. Now, his life himself, he has lots of examples of how he fought the system, or people tried to do him down, and how he became the chief of the army, how he won the 1971 war. So he is my hero in my professional life. In my personal life, my person who has motivated me the most is my wife, Priscilla Cardozo. She's not only my wife, she's not only the mother of my children, but she's also my girlfriend. My best girlfriend from the days that I courted her till today. We are very good friends. We love each other. She does everything for me, and I would do anything for her. But so there are two people in my life. One is Sam Manekshaw, and the other is my wife. Her name is Priscilla, Priscilla Cardozo. My wife, my mother of my children, and my girlfriend.
Sir, they also wanted to know if it was an arranged marriage or a love marriage. So you have to tell us something about how you met her.
Well, I first, I was on a course in Mao, and I was on, I was studying for an exam, towards the final exam of my course. And another friend of mine, we went to a mela, and I saw this nice looking girl with a beautiful smile. And I said to this officer of mine, who was there much for a year, I was there only for a couple of months. I said, who's that nice looking girl? So he said, just with a lovely smile. So he said, all those girls have lovely smiles. Which one do you mean? So I said, the one with the blue and white salwar kameez. Oh, he said, I know her. Come, I'll introduce you to her. So he took me to her, but she was a little embarrassed with her friends that I was, some stranger was coming to meet her. And he introduced me to her, but she said, oh, thank you very much. And then she's sort of, it finished there. And after that, I had to leave, and I went back to the jungles of Nifa, and I couldn't stop thinking about her. And after 2 years, when I came back on another course, my ancestors also were in Mao many, many years earlier. And I had gone, they told me that there is a friend of theirs, a doctor, who I should go and visit. And when I went to visit them, who should come out of the neighboring house but Priscilla.
Wow.
So I said, wow, she's here. And after that, I courted her, and I saw her in the swimming pool with her friends. And now 2 years had passed before I met her. So we became friends, and I taught them how to swim, and we did lots of lovely things together. And then I courted her. My course went for a 6, but I think I did. The best thing I did in my life was to happen to me in my life was to meet her, because she has been everything to me.
Wow. Thank you so much for sharing that, sir. While you're sharing things about Mrs. Cardozo, I also want you to share that incident that you told me about when you were not being able to walk when you were in the hospital, and she made you walk to the toilet.
No, you see, after I had actually 3 amputations. The one I did myself with my kukri, then the one done by a Pakistani officer in the battlefield, and the third one, because there was a lot of, I was not getting my medications on the evacuation, and my leg got infected, and there was one more amputation. And by that, Priscilla used to ask me, when shall I come to the hospital to see you? So I said, just wait a little longer, because I didn't know where she would stay. Then a course mate of mine, his wife, his sister was a doctor, she said, tell her to come and stay with us. So I passed the message to her, then I went in for my 3rd amputation. But when I came out from anesthesia, I saw somebody who looked like Priscilla. I thought maybe this is, hallucinating. And I went off to sleep again. And then I got up again, and I said, Priscilla, is that you? She said, yes, I'm here. So I said, have a look at my leg. She said, don't worry, I have the rest of my life to look at your leg now. I'm so glad that you are alive. After that, I was at peace with myself, and I fell into a deep sleep. And then the surgeon had told her that I should be made to walk, because the limb would heal better if the blood flowed down to the stump. So I wanted to go to the toilet. Luckily, there was an attached bathroom. So I told Priscilla, asked the ward boy to bring the bottle, and I want to go to the toilet. So she said, no, walk. And she gave me the crutches, and I walked, but the pain was so much that I blacked out and I fell down. And she, with the help of her nursing orderly, put me back on the bed. And I thought, now at least she'll allow me to call for the nursing orderly. So I said, can you call for the nursing orderly? She said, no. Walk.
That's awesome.
So I walked, and my leg healed far better because of her.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you so much. Over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. It was a nice incident you told me about the ma'am. For the next question, I would like to call Unnati Sirohi.
Good evening, sir. It's very nice meeting you today. I am Unnati from Delhi, 26 years old. So my question is, what impact does it how does a war changes a person? And what impact does it have on the mind of the soldier who closely experiences it?
I think that what all the listeners should know is that war teaches us soldiers to appreciate life, the meaning of life. It is only those who have lived with death, who have faced death every day of the war, and I fought 3 wars, that you understand the value of life. And every morning when I get up, I thank God that I'm still alive, because life means so much. So what the soldier learns is, number one, life is very precious. And what the listener should learn is that no one can really appreciate the value of life unless you have faced death. And secondly, that since you have got life, you must make the best of it, because you have only one life to live. And if God has given you a second chance, then you must make the best of what life offers. And therefore, this is what I think the soldier learns in battle, that life is very precious. And if you get a second chance, you must do the best. And then it also teaches us to be happy, because you can easily get demoralized and feel sad, but you have only one life to live, and it's good to be happy. But it's also better to make others happy. So giving is more important than receiving. So a soldier's life is always service before self. He's always looking at other people, how he can help others, whether it is in war when he has sometimes sacrificed his life, whether he helps people in floods and fires. And so the soldier is always dedicating his life to helping others. He understands that giving is more important than receiving. And life is short. And therefore, there's not much time. One should make the best of that time by making others happy. So, and the last thing is belief in oneself and belief in God. The armed forces and the people of India is a very spiritual country. We may have different faiths, we have different gods, but we all believe in God. And if one understands that if you believe in yourself and you believe in God, nothing can stop you from being happy and being confident and being a good human being, which is what basically life is all about. I hope I've answered your question.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
For the next question, I would like to call Shreya Shukla.
Good evening, sir. I'm Shreya Shukla and I'm 21 years old. I'm a defense aspirant, and I would like to ask you about any particularly humorous incidents you recall from the academy, NDA or IMA.
Humorous or eventful? Yeah. There were 2 incidents. They were not very humorous, but they were very meaningful. I was in my pre-final term. We have 6 terms in the NDA, and the 5th term, and I was a boxer. and my squadron was competing for the banner, that means the best championship banner. And I was a hockey captain. And the final, there were two events now which would take place, which would decide on which squadron would be the champion squadron. And boxing was an individual event. It had few points. And the hockey championship had many points. So if we won the hockey final, we would have won the banner. So I had to box the boxing captain. And the boxing captain was from Bangalore. And he was the Golden Gloves champion before he joined the NDA. He was a killer. He won all his fights by knockouts. And my squadron commander did not want me to fight. He said, if you get knocked out, and the hockey finals and the boxing was on the same day. Boxing was at 3 o'clock and hockey was at 5 o'clock. So I had to tell him that, sir, I can't walk away from this. It'll be an act of cowardice. I have to fight him. So I was allowed to fight him. But the point was that in that term, I was doing the Academy Cadet Adjutant. And I had rugged out the Academy. Not even here, rugged out. I punished them for doing things, wrong things. So they were very happy to see me getting knocked out. So the whole Academy came for that fight. And this guy, his name was Lebon Bosco, he was a killer. He was a friend, he was a course mate, but he won all his fights by knockouts, and he was going to win this fight also by a knockout. And my squadron commander didn't want me to fight. So to cut a long story short, I was given the thrashing of my life. I was bleeding from my nose, from my mouth, I was cut above the eye, and first round, I survived. Second round, I survived. But I had got such a thrashing in the second round that my eye had been cut above the eye, and the doctor was called to check whether I could continue the fight. He was a paratrooper. So man knows what paratrooping is all about. They're great soldiers. They're very brave. So this doctor was on the paratrooper, and he came and he looked at me. He said, no, he can fight. So I had to fight the third round. And again, I got such a bashing that my squadron commander threw the towel into the ring. When a towel is thrown into the ring, it means that this guy cannot fight anymore. Luckily, the referee asked me in front of, the commandant was there, all the officers were there. And the referee stopped the fight and he said, do you want to still fight or do you want to give up? I didn't like that word about give up. I said, no, sir, I'll fight. And I fought and I survived. And then there's another story to this. Many years later, my son, my eldest son, who joined the army and joined the same regiment, was a captain in Dalhousie. And the army chief, General Padmanabhan, visited that brigade. And when he came to the last junior most officer, he saw the name Cardozo on his chest. So he said, Cardozo? My son said, sir. So he said, any relation to General Cardozo? Yes, sir. Who is he to you? He's my dad, sir. Did your dad tell you about the thrashing he got in the NDA? So he said, no, sir. He said, tell him, I was the junior most cadet at that time, sitting on the floor of the workshop and seeing him getting thrashed. But also tell him that I admire his guts. So my son came on leave and said, Dad, did this happen? So I said, yes. So that was one, I don't know whether you find it humorous, but it was an incident which it actually made me, because the commandant was there and everybody was there and my squadron commander was there and I had to be stitched. I got 3 stitches on my eyebrow and I captained the final of the hockey team, of the hockey finals, and we won the match with, I had a bandage around my head. But my squadron commander felt that I could do no wrong. The commandant felt that I was, well, must have thought I was brave. So in my sixth term, I feel that it was this boxing bout which convinced them that that made me the academy cadet captain in my final term. So there's a lesson there for everyone. That is, do what you love, love what you do, don't be afraid, never give up.
Very nice. That's
thank you so much, sir. That's very inspirational.
Okay, thank you.
We are also having a volunteer with us, Palash Mangodi. He's also a MMA fighter. He's also a boxer.
Oh.
Palash, can you please switch on your video? Actually, he's traveling right now somewhere.
Yes, sir. Hi, sir.
Hi. Where are you?
Sir, I'm based in Mumbai, but right now I was traveling outskirts in the villages of Maharashtra to meet a friend.
Okay, good. That's nice.
We thought boxer to boxer, Palash is also doing a lot of boxing these days at Flame University, Pune. So, great, Palash, great. Have you been knocked out ever?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I'm not a boxer. I'm an MMA fighter. And I know what sir must have faced at that time. I also have gotten a lot of beating in my training and during the bouts.
What so is MMA? Really,
sir, MMA is mixed martial arts where you mix striking sports like boxing and ground game like wrestling together.
Okay, okay. Also kickboxing?
Right, sir.
Okay.
Right. Okay, all right. Sir,
I would also like to introduce one more guest with us, Mr. Omkar Sawant. He is a Taj. He is a Taj Hotel security director.
Oh,
Omkar sir, can you please unmute yourself?
Jain sir,
Jain Omkar.
Omkar Sawant.
Jain.
Well, it's a. It's actually a dream come true to, you know, even interact with you on Zoom. I'm actually in Dubai, been with the Taj Group for a long time. I was at the hotel when the attack happened on 26th November 2008.
Okay.
And I just wanted to thank you that, you know, your inspiring story is what pushed me and a couple of my colleagues who at some point of time had read your inspiring story, and that what pushed us into actually doing a lot of rescue work when the operations were on. And so I just wanted to thank you for all the inspiration.
Thank you, Ankar. Thank you, Ankar. Thank you. And God bless you. Do well in whatever you do.
Thank you,
For the next question, I would like to call Mr. Vipin Raut.
Jain, sir. Jain. My name is Vipin Raut. I am from Yavatmal, Maharashtra, and I am 19 years old. Sir, today I want to ask, since here are many defense aspirants, so we want to know from you, what qualities does army look for in a candidate?
If I was assessing a person, an aspirant, I would look for, and I think the selection boards also look for these qualities in a person. First question I'd like to ask, is he honest? Is he truthful? Does he do what he says he will do? Is he reliable? Is he prepared to work hard? Is he tough mentally and physically? Because you need to be tough physically, because you have tough assignments, you have tough missions. You also got to be mentally tough and not give up, because you're going to be a leader. As a leader, you have to lead men into battle. It's a calling which most people never have the privilege of leading men into battle. But it's tough, because many of those people you lead into battle are aware that many of them won't come back alive. And so leadership has to be of a very high order. And therefore, I would look for qualities of leadership is this person prepared to take charge? Is this person mentally tough enough to take over a situation when everything is against him? So, firstly, is he honest? Is he hardworking? Is he reliable? Is he mentally and physically tough? Is he confident? Because self-confidence is very important. In the army, we say that the possible we can do immediately, the impossible takes a little more time, which means that the impossible is also being done. So confidence in yourself, confidence in your command, in the people you train. So leadership, character, truthfulness, hardworking, reliability, and cooperation. Is he a team man? Is he selfish and only works for himself? Or does he work for the common cause? Can he work in a team? That's very important, because in battle, your life depends upon the man on the left and right of you, and his life depends upon you. So you have to work in a team. You have to be, cooperation is very important. Does he give up easily? So he should not give up easily. So when you go for the selection board, you will be asked these questions. They will ask you questions to test these aspects about your character. If you say something in your written, you're going to fill in a form in the beginning, and you say, for instance, my hobby is cricket. In the interview, they'll ask you all about cricket. And if you don't know anything about cricket, then you're not honest. So the interview will be testing you on all these issues. You must be honest. You must be reliable. You should be able to work hard. You should not give up on any of those tests. You should prove yourself to be physically fit. Sorry. And is he determined to do what he has to do? So these are the things that they will look at. And also what I said, is he happy? Does he make others happy? So that is a team person? These are the things I think they will look at. Sorry.
Thank you, sir. It was an honor to talk to you, and you are such a great source of inspiration for youth like us.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Bipin.
Sir, for the next question, I would like to call Sridhar Palange.
Good evening, sir.
Very good evening.
Yeah, sir, before coming to the question, let me tell you, sir, it's a great pleasure and honor being live with you. Truly, sir, as Omkar sir says, it's a dream come true, and I'm literally having goosebumps right now. And let me tell you, sir, I'll be telling my children and grandchildren that I had a live with a legend, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You made my day.
So coming to the question, you set a milestone by becoming the first physically challenged officer of the Indian Army to command. We want to know your mindset when you decided and asked your senior that you want to continue your service in the army. And I mean, what were the reactions, the first reactions of the people around you and your senior?
The situation wasn't a very happy one, Vipin, because I felt quite bad about it, in fact, because that was the only life I knew. I loved being in the army. I loved my unit. I loved my Gurkhas. I wanted to go back. But we had fought a war. We won that war. And now that the war was won, I felt that they had forgotten about us. They had felt that, well, now he's lost a leg. How useful is he going to be to us? So we were offered lots of concessions, job outside, gas agencies, petrol pumps, education, land, agricultural land, flats, etc., etc., etc. But I didn't want that. I didn't join the army for money. I joined the army for a way of life. I joined the army for adventure. I joined the army for the camaraderie of my friends I made in battle and otherwise, of my unit, of my regiment, of the army and India. I was doing something for India. And now that I had lost my leg, fighting for India, was I going to be stopped doing anything for more for my country? I didn't like it at all. So people around me felt that now he's lost a leg, so he is not much use to the army. I think I spoke about this earlier when I said that I felt that I could be as good as anybody else, but I did not know how and what I would do. It's a separate story altogether. But I did lots of things that convinced the army. But I was lucky. I was lucky to have a vice chief and a chief who said, yes, give him a chance to prove himself. And when I did the battle physical efficiency test, when I climbed a mountain and the vice chiefs reported to the chief that this boy can climb, he can walk, he can swim, he can do everything, why not give him a chance to prove himself? So I was lucky. And the chief called for my file and he said, yes, give him a battalion and other war wounded officers who are not taking shelter of their wounds. So, whereas the general feeling was that a person who loses a limb cannot command troops. It's a long story, but I fought the system for 7 years and I proved to the army that yes, I was as good as anybody else, and in some cases I was better. And I was lucky that the chief was there to accept my submission that I could command, and he gave me command of a battalion. So I was at that time only interested in command of a battalion. But when I was approved for brigadier's rank, the system again said, there's no one who's been promoted to brigadier's rank who has lost a leg. So I said, well, create a precedent. And I wrote to the different chief. But the different chief was the person who was my div commander in the Battle of Sylhet. And he said, of course, if he can command a battalion, physical standards, a higher standard are required in command of a battalion than a brigade. If he can command a battalion, why can't he command a brigade? So I was lucky. I had army chiefs who had the guts to take decisions without running to the bureaucrats and running to the government to ask permission. They said, yes, give him a battalion, give him a brigade. So I was lucky. But the lesson here for everybody else is that God helps those who help themselves. And luck comes to the way to the person who works hard. You have to do your best and God will do the rest. I hope I've answered your question, Vipin.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And in the starting, we were missing our one of the volunteer, Aman. He is back and he will ask you the next question.
Okay.
Aman.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Aman.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
You're welcome.
So, sir, my question is that what is your advice and your expectation and your suggestion to the youth? Because most of us are youth in this session. So,
I think I've already answered this question in the sense that but I'll repeat, I'll sum it up for you, is my message to everybody is what Sam Manekshaw said. Do what you love. Love what you do. Never be afraid. Never give up. And also, India is a spiritual country. We are brought up at home to believe in God. So believe in yourself. Believe there is, there was a battle called the Battle of Dograi, where the men were Hindus and Muslims, and the commanding officer was a Christian, and they were target tasked to capture a place called Dograi. And they captured Dograi, and many people died, many people got wounded, but the brigade could not reinforce them, and they were told to come back. They had to cross a canal and come back. They came back, but they considered this a slur on their honor that they were asked to come back. And when they had to capture Dograi again, the Pakistanis had reinforced that place with armor and artillery and infantry, and some other battalion was given the chance to capture Dograi. But the CEO of this battalion, Three Jat, he talked to the men and he said, we had captured Dograi. Then we were asked to come back. Who should have the honor of capturing Dograi again? And the men said, Three Jat. And he said, I'll tell you one thing. Many more of you, of us, will die. Many more of us will be wounded. But if I die, I want you to carry my body into Dograi, because I want to be there with you tomorrow morning. And then he said, where will we be tomorrow morning? And the whole battalion said, roared and said, Dograi. And they captured Dograi again. So he said something, because he, the same officer, was my platoon commander in the IME. And he said, which you almost try to understand what he meant by that. He said, battles are won or lost in the mind before they are won or lost on the ground. And therefore, the message I would like to tell everybody is, believe in yourself, believe in your team, your regiment, whatever, if you are on a city street, your team, believe in God, and you will overcome every problem. And lastly, don't forget your country. Believe in India. Believe in the people of India, because that is why we are here, to protect them and make India the best country in the world. So that is my message. Believe in yourself. Believe in God. Believe in India, and we will overcome all problems.
Thank you so much, sir. I think that has been so inspiring for all of us to hear all of this from you.
Thank you so much, Rasna. God bless you. Thank you for calling me.
Sir, we are running out of time, but just one question. One of your fans, Vivek Bhatt from Dehradun, he wants to know, what is war like in real life? We glamorize wars and we see movies about wars, but he wants to know, how is it when you're in the battlefield? How does it feel? So a very quick question, sir, and then we'll write.
Yeah, okay. So war is something, you know, it's glamorized in the movies, it's glamorized in comics, it's glamorized in books. But war is all about life and death. It involves sacrifice. It involves leadership of the very highest order. It involves morale. It involves leadership. And it involves sorrow. Sorrow for the loss of your friends. And you might yourself die. So when you join the armed forces, be very clear that you're not going to join a profession which is all a bed of roses. It's a tough life. You've got to be tough. But the very fact that you are there, prepared to give your life for your country, you are doing the most difficult job, because life is very precious. But you will feel that you are really superior to everybody else. Not that I'm asking you to be arrogant, but you, in a very humble way, you should realize your value to this country, your value to the people of India, and the fact in war, when you face death every moment of your life in those battles, you understand the value of life. And so, it's difficult, but let me tell you one thing. Your family training, your family in the NDA and IMA are so good that you have no time to think about yourself. You have no time to be afraid. As an officer, you have got so much responsibility, so much accountability. You are responsible for your troops. there is no time to be afraid. So be assured that after your training, you can face any problem, including battle. And battle experience makes you stronger to face bigger challenges in the next battle. So that's what war is all about.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Lalit, sir, just 5 more minutes, sir.
So, one more thing I just wanted to ask you. I know from my secret sources that you're working on something these days. So would you like to tell your fans what it is? There is something that's going to come up in the next few months.
Yeah, I'm working on 2 books. One, my publisher who published my first 2 books wanted me to write my own story. And they asked me this about 8 years ago, and I said, no, I don't want to write my own story, because the army has taught me that we don't blow our own trumpet and beat our own drum. But after I've seen what is happening around us, I don't want to explain, but the point is that all the questions that you asked me today, the people of India need to know about it. And therefore, I decided to write my story. And the title of the book, as you might have guessed, is Kartusa.
Yeah.
Wow, sir.
I'm excited about it, sir.
We're looking forward to that book, sir.
Yeah. And then thanks to Rashna ma'am, who introduced me to Penguin. I'm also writing a book of short stories on the 71 war. So I'm doing these 2 things at the same time.
So we're looking forward to both the books, sir.
Thank you, Rachna.
Over to you, Lalit.
Thank you.
Sir, we have one artist with us who has made a sketch of you. Shankar, can you show that sketch to sir?
Wow, that's very nice.
It's amazing, amazing.
This is made by Akhil, and he is also an army aspirant. Akhil, can you please switch on your video?
Good evening, sir.
Hello. Good evening, Akhil. Where are you? Hi, Akhil.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. I'm from Haryana. I'm 21 years old, and I'm also an army aspirant, sir. And
okay,
I'm a 9-time SSB repeater, sir.
Oh, wow. So, oh, wonderful. You're very, very good.
Beautiful.
Thank you, sir.
Can you send me a copy of that?
Yes, sir, sure.
We'll do that, sir. Have a copy sent to you.
Thank you so much.
Akhil, can you hold the portrait up one more time? I have to take.
Thank you, Akhil. That is very nice.
Thank you, sir.
And sir, lastly, I asked you yesterday night about the song. Shankar will sing the song for you, sir.
Okay, lovely.
Sir, I was thinking about what songs to sing. So then I thought I'll go with one of my favorite English songs that I have. That is Country Roads, Take Me Home.
Oh, lovely. It's lovely. I love it.
Great. Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, blowing like a breeze. Country roads, take me home to the place I belong, West Virginia. Mountain mama, take me home down country roads. Thank you, sir.
Lovely.
Thank you, sir. That was wonderful.
Thank you.
Lovely, sir. Lovely. And that's my favorite song also.
Okay.
I wish you all the best in your competition.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Shriya. Thank you, Rashna.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir.
God bless you all. All the best to all your aspirants.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
God bless you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. God bless.
Bye.
Jain, sir.
Jain.
Jain, sir.